Holy cow. So freaking pod.
Chapter 12.
Oh, shit.
12.
Do you want to do it again or
no,
do you want to leave it in?
I think we should leave it in.
I'm Cherrydoom.
I'm Cherrydoom.
I'm Chad.
I'm Cherrydoom and I have a bunch of cereal in the scarf. Oh no. Hey, so we read this book again for chapter 12. Alright, here's the summary. Anastasia goes for a run. When she comes back, she sends Christian a jokey email like, "See you in hell, butthead," implying that she doesn't want to do the agreement, like, "It's been nice knowing you," is a bit more accurate. 20 minutes or so later, Anastasia looks up from reading the contract and finds him standing in her room, staring at her quietly. He says some ominous stuff and then ties her to the bed. He covers her eyes and just leaves her there for a bit while he goes to secure some vittles. There's some foreplay with ice, with the most uncomfortable dirty talk ever, and then sex. Afterwards, Anastasia cries a shitload and has to be comforted by Kate. Why could that be? Anyways, Christian sends her a shouty email and she goes to bed. And because they had sex, I've summarized the sex time summary. Anastasia gets tied up. Christian blindfolds her with her own shirt and leaves the room. He comes back with wine and it all over her body and in her mouth. At some point during this, he unblindfolds her. He fingers her, slaps her butt, boner time, and then that's it. She comes like 70 times, or maybe it's 1 to 2 times, and then he comes once. So there you go.
She does say that she comes instantly again and again.
Okay, so maybe it is like 70 times.
Yep.
Like 70, a very accurate number.
We don't have much to go on, honestly.
Pet theories. I have one this time. Christian's hand, whatever hand he's using to manipulate Anastasia, is a male channeler, all of Robert Jordan's Wheel of Time book series. Here's the quote. "My legs begin to stiffen as I push against his hand. He gentles his hand, so I'm brought back from the brink. Christian's hand has the ability to tap tainted Sidon, what gives male channelers their powers. But he gentles his hand so that it does not harm Anastasia and eventually go insane."
What's, I'm not familiar with this series.
In the Wheel of Time books, there are these kind of like people can do magic, but the way they do it is quote-unquote channeling, and I would describe it sort of like Jedi powers, but with more stuff, like witches and wizards. And the way that, okay, the ladies do it with, by like making weaves in the air or whatever, and different stitches or whatever make different magics happen. Men do it by like riding the wave, dude, basically. I don't remember because it's been a while since I read it.
Oh, okay. I thought it meant that he channeled males.
It's magic.
Okay.
So I said so the reason that women will draw from it and not be punished is there's nothing wrong with it, but the story goes that fantasy Satan made the male magic like evil, so that if males used magic too much, they would go insane and evil. Society basically tries to gentle them. In other words, it takes away their ability to do magic.
Is this a good series?
Yes.
I will check it out.
Okay.
My theory is that Anna is a robot. When Christian sends her the shouty capitals, she says, "I switch off." Then, early in the chapter, he, quote, scoops her hair off her head. So, I mean, obviously, he's taking it off so that he could get into her brain guts. One of the great things about robots is that you can put different wigs on them.
So, are you saying that she's a cyborg or a robot?
Robot. Straight up robot.
Okay.
Also, I want to point out that E.L. James probably meant sign off the computer and not switch off the computer. Or rather, she's talking about the computer here, but she doesn't say switch off the laptop. She just says switches off.
Yeah, I know. I think that's an American thing.
Oh, interesting.
Also, Kate's treatment of her afterwards, like where she's like brushing her hair. I don't know. It gave me an interesting like creator / creation vibe. That's just me projecting my robot love onto. Aww.
Like a little girl playing with her pony toys and brushing their manes.
I was thinking more like a Frankenstein, like, "Why cannot find love?"
So is Anna's true love really Taylor, the other robot?
I don't know.
I think a robot can love a human.
I'm not saying they can't, but I'm saying they can't. Don't date robots.
Maybe Anastasia was made for Taylor, but she's falling in love with humans because she's like,
No, see, that sounds like an interesting book. That's not what this is.
Chad, do you have any?
Yes, it's related to a thing I just said. Perhaps Christian is related to Professor Hubert Farnsworth because of this particular line, which I now only associate with that character, even though it's a really common phrase, which is, "A man can dream."
A man can dream.
He famously says after he's finished watching the tale of what would have happened if he'd invented the thing longer.
Oh, yes.
That's my pet theory.
Now we are on to mechanics. Quote, "But that's 5 miles, and I don't think I'll be able to run 1 mile, let alone 5. And of course, He might turn me down, which would be beyond humiliating. This is lacking a comma. He might turn me down. Or, well, really the way it should go, but that's 5 miles, comma, and I don't think I'll be able to run 1 mile, comma, let alone five, period. And, of course, he might turn me down, comma, which would be beyond humiliating. So that flows a lot better, and if you don't fix it, it is a run-on sentence. But I can't tell you why. It's just too many clauses or whatever. Next. There are only so many ways one can say dash italics. You look fabulous, Kate. There's no comma there, first of all. You look fabulous, Kate. When one can say something, typically you would put that thing that they can say in quotation marks.
That's actually different in the print copy.
Oh, really?
Yep, it's actually in quotes. There are only so many ways you can say comma, open quote, you look fabulous, Kate, period, end quote. They actually formatted it right.
Anyway, it made me really mad. Next. He reaches down, and from his pants pocket, he takes out his silver gray silk tie. Dot, dot, dot. That silver-gray woven tie that leaves small impressions of its weave on my skin. Did you notice that there's not a comma in that next thing after the dot, dot, dot? It should say,
Should it?
Yeah, it should. Listen. That silver-gray woven tie that leaves small impressions of its weave on my skin. That silver-gray woven tie, comma, that leaves small impressions of its weave on my skin. Because she's, like, reflecting on the tie.
I don't know about that.
Really?
I've read that, like, if you're referring to that thing...
Actually, you know what? If it was the silver-gray woven silk tie, that would be better. But that silver-gray woven silk tie may not. I don't know why that is. I don't know. I don't know. It just doesn't sound right to me.
It sort of depends on the feel. Like, I hate to be down on E.L. James again about her writing, but, like, more talented writers, you can play with comma usage a little bit because you can change phrasing and pacing by doing that. I think the way that this is technically is fine. But if perhaps she wanted to give it a slightly different feel, like the way that you suggested, putting a comma there would break it up it would give it a different tone. But as it stands now, this is a little more, like, the pacing is faster.
Right. Well, like, that's kind of what confuses me. I don't think the pacing should be that fast. Like, bah, 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 bah. Like, wouldn't you, isn't it sensual?
I mean, okay, like, let's say, like, if you were saying the goat that ate the grass, like, you wouldn't put a comma after that, after goat.
That goat, the one that ate my grass.
Yeah. That would definitely need a comma, but if you're doing the goat that ate the grass, it would be the goat, comma, that ate the grass.
Yeah,
that's
but...
the goat that ate the grass. That goat.
But you have to make it more fitting analogy, like, okay, that silver-gray goat that leaves small impressions of its hooves on my skin.
Well, okay, well, how about, like, let me try reading. So, he reaches down from his pants pocket, he takes out a silver-gray silk tie. That silver-gray woven tie that leaves small impressions of its weave on my skin.
That's how it is right now,
yeah.
Right? Okay. So then try it again.
Etc., etc. That silver gray woven tie that leaves small impressions on its weave of my...
my skin. That wasn't how I intended it. It's like this. He takes out his silver gray silk tie. That silver gray woven tie, comma, that leaves small impressions of its weave on my skin. So that is emphasized. That's how I read that. And then I was like, hey, this isn't right.
Yeah, but I don't think that's how it's supposed to be read.
Really?
No offense. Yeah, that emphasis wouldn't be there. She'd have to put like an italics in there.
Oh, you know what? You know what? I am wrong.
Yeah, like that silver gray tie.
The one.
Yeah, yeah.
Period. The one that leaves small impressions on his weave on his skin.
I got confused. That was what I was proposing that should be done. I don't know why my notes, I didn't transpose them correctly.
It's okay.
I'm sorry.
It's
all right.
Okay.
Delete all that.
Yeah.
Commas are kind of a bitch.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but they're very important. So anyways, what I meant to say is that silver gray silk tie that leaves small impressions on his weave on my skin should actually be... that silver gray woven tie, comma, the one that leaves... Okay, you got the idea. Bye. Anyways, next. He pops a fragment of ice in my navel in a pool of cold, cool wine. Cool and cold are synonyms. I mean, stylistically, it might be okay, but I'm going to go ahead and say this is actually incorrect. I really don't like this.
Do you know what page that's on? Because that's really bad.
What if it's like... first it feels cool, but then it gets cold because it's on her skin longer, so she's like in a pool of cool cold wine.
Yeah, but that doesn't...
Yeah, then that just speaks to Anna being an incompetent fool.
Okay, in the PDF I have, it's, I believe it's 137.
Yeah, because cool cold wine.
Cool cold wine.
That is terrible.
Yeah, I mean, I probably should have put it in wording, but I think we can say it's a mechanical problem, because... you might have wanted to say something else, like stinging cold wine or like amazing cold wine. I don't know. Okay, next. Is this nice? He asks, but I hear the edge in his voice. Paragraph break. I tense. That paragraph break was unnecessary. Here's another. Ready for me so soon, he says. He moves his fingers tantalizingly slowly in, out, and I push against him, tilting my hips up. Paragraph break. You are a greedy girl, he scolds softly, etc. Okay, so that one I just gave you is especially bad because when somebody is writing dialogue, somebody needs to be very careful about paragraph break rules because usually if somebody else is speaking, that's when you paragraph break. You don't break up the action before somebody else speaks.
Right.
Or rather, you do break up the action before somebody else speaks, but you don't do it until that that condition is fulfilled. So it needed to be the same paragraph, and it's very hard to read that. I mean, I guess the fact that there's only two of them sort of, you know, narrows it down a little bit. But still, I don't know, Kate could have come in the room and said some stuff. Next one. I am beyond warm. Warm and chilled and wanting. I just wrote the word train wreck next to this one. Here's the punctuation of it. I am beyond warm, dash, warm and chilled and wanting. No commas in there. Not warm, chilled, and wanting. There's some kind of disagreement here between warm and chilled. Like, which are you? Which are you, bitch? And if you can be both, then you need to say what is warm and what is chilled. Like, my body is warm, but my stomach is cold or something. Like, you know, it's just bad. But I think this is another classic example of thinking like, oh, if I cut myself off, it's going to sound sexy, but it doesn't. And it's just a train wreck. So that was it for me.
Kate is trying on bikinis. She's making Anna watch her with looks stunning in all these bikinis. There are only so many ways one can say, you look fabulous, Kate. She has a curvy, slim figure to die for. She doesn't do it on purpose, I know, but I haul my sorry perspiration-clad ass into my room. That was really confusing. Like, it sounded like Anna going into her room was the thing that Kate didn't do on purpose.
Yeah, like...
I mean, I know, like, indirectly, that is sort of the cause, but it's just... It's very awkward, and I get what she's trying to say, but it just doesn't...
Like, okay, so what I had said here was that the but, whatever comes after but in that sentence does not modify her doing it on purpose. Like, you know what I mean? Like it sort of does. Like, it happens as a result of her doing it not on purpose, but, like...
Yeah.
So on page 190, there is a paragraph of Anna describing Christian once he's in her room. My heart is pounding. I can feel that pull of the delicious electricity between us charging, filling the space with static. He's sitting so close to me, his eyes dark, smoky gray, his elbows resting on his knees, his legs apart, leaning forward. And then there's a bunch of other description. Anyway, the description is all really bad, and it's all, like, extremely unnecessary detail about to paint some sort of an image. However, the image is extremely boring and bland and laborious and...
But is it wrong?
Like, it's straightforward in this strangely clinical way that is it's sort of unclear when and why E.L. James decides to have her weird, gross, or, like, childish descriptions, and then, like, her just straightforward, like, he's sitting on my bed, his legs are apart, his eyes are dark and smoky gray, I am looking at him, we are now sitting and talking, and this is what is happening.
Is this really a mistake, though? Is this really a mechanical mistake? Is it?
Well, I thought mechanics was sort of the place to put, like, writing things.
Yeah, okay, it is also that. But, like, I want to know how it is mechanically incorrect.
It's not. There's nothing mechanically wrong with this paragraph. I just mean...
Mechanically weird? That is one thing.
Yeah, I think in some ways. But I think mostly... I was thinking mostly in terms of style. But if you want to comment on mechanics, that's fine, too. Like, you did something stick
really,
out to you?
I don't really. I guess I was just being mean. I'm saying it should have gone in a different section. Okay. But anyways, you may continue.
Okay. Next, he slowly undoes one of my pigtails. His fingers freeing my hair. Okay, this probably does belong in wording. Because that's silly. Like, he's probably going to use his fingers to undo the pigtail.
He uses his mouth. That's sexy, right? pulling on a hair tie with your teeth. Ugh.
Pull out her sweaty hair tie. Sting his eyes with all the sweat.
See, the thing is that somebody is finding that sexy as you say that. So I wouldn't be so judgmental.
Someone just gripping their eyes in pain like, oh, it's so salty.
No, I said sexy.
Yeah, that's
salty.
Hot.
Oh, so salty, yeah.
Rub it in my wounds.
All right, you can continue. I liked your note on this, by the way. It's really funny.
Okay, my note is, obviously his fingers are doing that. He's not going to do it with his dick, is he? Is he?
He might.
I don't know, is he? A prehensile dick.
We'll have to write E.L. James. Okay, next... So these next couple are all on the same page. She does it again, like, loosens the braid with his long, skilled fingers. Yes. It's so sexual. How is it sexual? She's describing... So this follows, like, just description of what's going on, and then she's like...
This sex is so sexual.
Yeah, wow.
He's undoing my hair, sexually. He's untying my shoes, in a sexy way.
It's kind of like when she says that seeing him walk around the room while she's tied up is an aphrodisiac.
Yeah, it's exactly in the same vein as, like, oh, he's walking around the room. That's an aphrodisiac. His pants are hanging from his hips in that way. He's taking off his baseball cap sexually. Then the next thing, and this was pretty egregious, I'm all deer slash headlights, comma, moth slash flame, comma, bird slash snake, ellipsis, and then there's something after that. And my note is just fuck, 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 fuck.
I have to emulate what you're doing here. Fuck! 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 Slapping the keyboard as well.
Well, I mean, these are like classic pairing, classic slash pairings, you know, deer slash headlights. Who could forget that amazing romance or the forbidden love between moth and flame?
Moth and flame, the deadly romance.
The secret glances of the bird slash snake.
So the bird slash snake one kind of confuses me only because, like, it's a little different from the other ones, where, like, are snakes and birds attracted to each other? And, like, deer
are
caught in
headlights.
Yeah, a bird
is not drawn to a snake.
Don't snakes, like, hypnotize their prey?
Only mice, though. Or, like, not mice, but rodents tend to be hypnotized by their movements. I think that's right. I would say, by the way, that that snake is actually a typo, and she meant to write snack, bird and snack, because the bird is drawn to the snack.
So, page 191. This is the description of Anna, like, lunging at Christian on the bed, and then Christian somehow judo flipping her onto her back and pinning her to the bed, which this is totally a thing that could happen. But the way that it's, like, written is sort of basically comes off as, like, I don't know what Christian does, but he does a thing, and then suddenly he's on top of me, and I don't know what's going on. Like, that's basically how the paragraph reads to me.
I love how your worldview allows that Aikido flip on the bed to happen. You're like, well, yes, okay, I accept it if you do these things.
Martial arts play an important role in my worldview, and basically all interpersonal reactions end in some sort of jujitsu or Aikido.
Parting ways with a bow, at least. At the very least.
Yes, but you have to, and this is an important note for martial arts, especially Japanese martial arts. When you're bowing to your opponent, you do not look at the ground because it could kick you in the face. Yes, that's my martial arts chat. Page 192, gag me, Kate, I shut up. I just hate this sentence. It just...
Gag me? Kate!
When I first, like, I saw this on the, when I was, okay, I was, like, skimming through to see what I'd underline, and I saw that line, like, out of context. And I just thought of, like, you know, 80s slang, gag me, Kate, ugh, shut up.
Yeah. And you're like, ugh, I hate her.
That's what I was thinking when I read it. I was like, gag me with a spoon, Kate. But that's a little too modern for E.L. James' taste, I think.
Yeah, perhaps she should have thumbed her nose at Kate.
Oh, is that too old? Because basically the only Brit lit that we've had referenced at all is Tess of the D'Urbervilles.
True.
Anyway, page 194, I'm a ball of sexual tense need. That sentence doesn't really make any sense.
I just think of, like, a video game boss that is just a sphere, of which I think there are probably many, but I'm thinking of Ozma from Final Fantasy IX.
Yeah.
Just like this, just super compressed ball that is gonna destroy your party members.
Because it just needs release, but not in the Final Fantasy X sense.
No.
Not in the sending. Yeah, so she could have rewritten this to be like, I'm a tense ball of sexual need, or I'm a ball of tense sexual need, but I'm a ball of sexual tense need? That doesn't really make any sense to me.
Oh, you're right. Sexual tense need. That's like a really weird... Yeah,
I had that underlined too. I thought it was very strange, but I didn't know exactly. Like, it should be like, I'm a ball of sexually tense need? Tense need?
I still think just switching them. Tense sexual need. Yeah, or I'm a tense ball of sexual need. Like, mm-hmm. Either of those I feel would be much better. Okay, and that's all for me.
Okie doke. Shall we move on to Americans?
Yes.
But, like, did we make it clear what we mean by that? Have we just been saying this the whole time, thinking that we're funny? I feel like we mentioned it in, like, episode 2. American, like, she's trying to be American in her speaking... The characters, I mean, but they just can't. She America-can't do it! That was the joke, if everybody has forgotten.
We'll remind you every few episodes.
He pulls at my binding, checking it secure. There's... Okay, no comma, by the way. He pulls at my binding, checking it secure. To me, that reads like a very severe mistake, but I think that it could probably be very English. It sounds like it could be. And again, this is something that we would need input on. I will read it again. He pulls at my binding, checking it secure.
So you're saying either it needs a comma or it's very British?
No. I don't believe that it's correct to say checking it secure. Like, checking that it is secure.
Oh yeah, that's definitely British, I think.
Because if you say checking it's secure, it sounds like she's replacing it with binding. Checking binding secure. You can't check the secure of something. And you can check that it is secure.
No, if it was, if that was that, then the apostrophe would be on the other side of the S.
It's is? No.
Checking it is secure.
It's still, you wouldn't move the apostrophe based on.
Yes, you would, because if you were checking it's secure and it was possessive, like you're saying.
No, you just remove the apostrophe.
Yeah, that's right. Sorry.
And yeah, I think pulls out my binding comma, checking it's secure would be nice, but that's not necessarily why I picked this passage.
I guess, I don't know. I think I sort of use this construction for things. I mean, like, sometimes in writing, I don't say it.
He knows when you are sleeping. He's checking it's secure. When you put it that way, it makes more sense to me. Like, now I understand because I sang that song. But it still sounds something. It sounds something that is more English in tone than American, even if it's not wrong.
That's very interesting.
Mine was just the thing about her switching off. I think that might be a British, like, switching off as in, like, a computer analog of hanging up or just, you know, turning off the computer. I think that might be slang.
Okay, you might be right, but I don't know.
And I do not have anything.
Yeah, there wasn't really much to find in the chapter, I feel like. Okay, now we're on to wording. Taking the awesome free technology with me. I set the laptop up on my desk. I email Christian. This is just atrocious wording. I know there's nothing wrong with it, but like that, what a weird way to break up the action. Taking the free technology with me. I set it up on my desk. I email Christian. Those taps were periods. It's just, that's all.
There should also be a comma between awesome and free.
Well, no, not necessarily. It could be awesome that something is free. Awesome can modify free, as well as technology.
I think both are modifying technology.
I'm right with there not being a comma here, for reasons that I can't explain. It just intrinsically feels okay to me.
Actually, I agree. I think, you know, I take the awesome free technology.
I guess personally I can't see a way that awesome would modify free.
I'm just saying, like, free technology is one.
And it doesn't necessarily have to be comma, is how I feel. Okay. I don't know, by the way, we always accept viewer input. Email us at holycast.com.
It's holycastsofreakingpod@gmail.com.
Now, vaguely, I'm aware that I'm still in my sweats. Unshowered. Yucky. And he's just gloriously yummy. His pants doing that hanging from the hips thing. And what's more, he's here in my bedroom. Not once was that split up into multiple sentences. Not a one single fucking period in that whole section. It was comma, 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 comma. She probably should have cut off. I'm aware that I'm in my sweats, unshowered yucky, period. He's just gloriously yummy. And what's more, he's here in my bedroom. And yes, it's a very bad run-on sentence. Besides that, I mean, it's not here for that mechanic alone. It's just a disgusting sentence. He's yummy. I'm yucky.
Yeah, I just didn't like that she wrote the thing about she did the pants hanging from the hips thing again. Still don't know what's so sexy about it.
Yeah, what is the thing?
I don't know, maybe his pants are like super ripped or something. They just have abs.
Two snap-on buttons on each of his hip bones. And the sweats just like clip to the buttons.
So Anna's just really into like body modification? To hang from his hips in that way that pretty much no one else has. Yeah, I didn't, there was the pants thing, and then Anna calling herself yucky. Like, what is she, like a child? And then...
Ew, yucky.
Again... Anna describes Christian as being yummy, and this time he's gloriously yummy, which is an improvement over just regular yummy, I guess. But sometimes I just don't have a firm handle on what sort of a vocabulary Anastasia is really supposed to have, because she's not that eloquent even in her own thoughts as you might expect her to be, given that she's supposed to be a British literature-centric English major.
You know, maybe James was angling for the fact that because she can have Anastasia speaking in an English dialect, that it's going to seem like she's really smart.
But she's supposed to be American.
Yeah, I know, but the fact that she's an American speaking in an English dialect.
Oh, well, yeah. No, it just makes her seem like she's confused and...
She just sounds idiotic.
She's unstuck in time or something.
Finally, my medulla oblongata recalls its purpose. Comma. I breathe. Oh my god. Anastasia is literally such a horrible and stupid character that her brain actually literally stops working.
Also, isn't that the incorrect part of her brain?
I don't know. Medulla oblongata. If it handles involuntary things, then yes.
Lower half of the brainstem. Yeah, I think that is correct. Yeah, cardiac, respiratory, vomiting, and pass the motor.
So she's barfing, her heart stopped, and she stopped breathing. Also, if you didn't notice, it is a comma crime. Finally, my medulla oblongata recalls its purpose, comma, I breathe.
So it really sounds like she's saying that. Finally, my medulla oblongata recalls its purpose, I breathe.
It's true.
She says that to Christian. She's like, finally, my medulla oblongata is back, Christian.
He doesn't have anything to say about it, I guess.
He doesn't really care if she's breathing or not. Well, actually, he does. He said that explicitly.
He's not into necrophilia. Okay, so when they are starting their little sex scene, he ties her up and then he blindfolds her with a shirt and he walks out of the room, quote, to get a drink. So then, as he's out of the room, there's this little section where she's like trying to figure out what he's doing, and I'm going to read it for you guys. Get a drink. Where? Here? Portland? Seattle? I strain to hear him. I can make out low rumblings, and I know he's talking to Kate. Oh no, he's practically naked. What's she going to say? I hear a faint popping sound. What's that? He returns, the door creaking once more, his feet padding across the bedroom floor, and ice tinkling against the glass as it swirls in liquid. What kind of drink? He shuts the door and shuffles around, removing his pants. They drop to the floor, and I know he's naked. Very dramatic. I struggled to crystallize my thoughts here because there's so many. The thing that stands out the most is that it sounds like the glass is actually suspended in liquid. Ice tinkling against the glass as it swirls in liquid. It sounds like the glass is swirling in liquid. When he shuts the door and shuffles around, removing his pants, there's no comma. Maybe it's not wrong, but to me it sounds wrong. He shuts the door and shuffles around, removing his pants. He shuffles around, removing his pants. Like, in other words, he doesn't remove them, because he's shuffled around it. But somehow they drop to the floor anyway, and she knows he's naked! I know he's naked! How did you know? Do you know that he's not wearing underwear? Okay, the very last thing is, she can make out low rumblings, and I know he's talking to Kate, so what, like a earthquake or like a train going by?
He's doing his, like, concrete mancy.
Yeah, his concromancy. The low rumblings. Now, so is this canon now that he has, like, a very, very low voice?
When you hear thunder rumbling in the sky, no, it is I, Christian Grey, speaking to your friend Kate in your house. Okay, so I have a quick question about this passage. So obviously the faint popping sound is uncorking a bottle of white wine, but what else could it have been? What do we think?
Kate breaking his arm.
Well, that would be more of a snap. It could be like, what about bubble wrap?
What about, like, dislocation? That's popping.
Maybe it's bubble wrap from the unpacking the computer.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he decided to take a moment to stomp on the bubble wrap. So fun!
Maybe they're crushing some grapes to make the wine.
Such a wine obsession in this. Here we go. His other hand scoops my hair off my head and holds my head in place. His tongue mirrors the actions of his fingers, claiming me. So what it sounds like is he takes off all of her hair and then starts scrabbling at the bald head with his tongue. It, like, holds it in place with his tongue. These guys are aliens. More proof, my friends. Two more. Christian has this little refrain of, is this nice? Because, like, she had said at some point, like, oh, how nice of you, or something like that. I don't fucking care. It's creepy and unnecessary to say it that often. We'll get into the creepiness of it later, but just one... Was that nice would have been fine at the very end of the sex if she really needed to do that joke.
It was actually because of the email.
Yeah, because she says, nice knowing you, and he was like, I'm going to remind you how nice it was knowing me.
Yeah, but then he shouldn't continually be like, it's nice, it's nice.
And he was trying to do a Mr. Freeze impression. Nice to see you. Except it doesn't work because, you know, Christian's kind of dumb.
Yeah, kind of dumb. Yeah, it was too much. It was not necessary to continually say it to the extent that she says it. That he says it.
Yeah.
That the writer writes.
He's very aggressive. Like, it's like more of a, it's actually like a challenge. Like, he's throwing it back at her.
You could do that, like, once or whatever. Uh-oh. I need to go tell somebody to shut the fuck up. Hold on a second. She smiles, but her eyes crinkle at the corners with concern.
I'm doing it right now. It's possible. Don't worry.
How can you do it without also moving your mouth?
It's kind of like a piteous... Well, what do you mean also
but
moving,
like,
your mouth?
But they don't crinkle at the corners. They, like, your eyebrows go like, you know? You know, like, when you narrow your eyes, that's when they crinkle. So,
You narrow your eyes without moving your mouth.
But with concern, which I associate with more wincing look.
Yeah, I guess so.
It seems a little strange. Like, you would say, like, maybe that, like, her...
Her brow furrows...
Kate does a sad comedy concern face.
Okay, she grabs her, quote, nasty never use sneakers. How are they nasty if she never uses them? Like, I'm assuming she means that they're stinky, but if they're never used, how are they stinky? Or maybe she means just, like, aesthetically nasty. As someone who's been shopping for running shoes recently, I can attest that there are some very ugly running shoe designs.
Maybe she wore them once and it was just a terrible day.
Maybe.
Just, she got mud all over them, she was in a park, she kept stepping in dog poop, never cleaned them.
Maybe they're just nasty for the mere reason that they're used for sports, which I find a little strange.
Okay, so Christian ties her to the bed with the tie, and she says, I'm tied, literally, to my bed. At first I was like, of course she's literally tied to the bed. He tied her to the goddamn bed. And then I realized that she meant because she was tied with a tie, and it was a joke.
Yeah, I didn't get this until you pointed it out in the notes.
I did not. I had that somewhere too, and I want to comment on that. Oh yeah, here we go. I'm tied literally to my bed, and I'm so aroused. But, okay, I get that it's a joke, but, like, what's the alternative? Figuratively tied to my bed? Spiritually tied to my bed?
There's a reason this joke doesn't really work, because a tie is called a tie because it ties. So, like, it's still not really that clever. It sort of is, but, like, it almost is. It's on the brink of being a joke.
I mean, she could be, like, figuratively tied to the bed if, like, he said,
don't get off the bed.
Don't move. Don't move.
Yeah.
And she was like, oh, I'm tied by his words. He doesn't need any rope. I'll just do whatever he tells me.
I'm emotionally tied to the bed.
He raises her from birth to believe that the bed is her mother, and if she leaves, her mother will die.
That's really creepy. Okay, so I read this with a friend. Would he need a comedy-length clown tie to do what he's describing here?
What is it?
Okay, so it says that he ties her to the bed with a tie, but at the same time, he also has to be able to flip her over, because that's what he does later on. So it either needs to be loose enough that he can do this, or he needs to tie it so, like, the very end is tying her wrists, and then the other end is long, goes out, and goes around the bed.
I'll be right back.
Sure. Is she going to test it out?
I think this is possible.
Okay. Ties are, like, pretty long by themselves, and
I mean, I have a tie too. I'm gonna fucking get it.
I just got mine.
Beep, 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 beep.
Yes, I think it's definitely possible. He could tie her wrists together with the fat end.
Basically, like, if he just, well, I see, my conception of what he did was that bound her wrists, and as he was doing, he did it by tying around one of the posts on her wrought iron bed. So, like,
right.
Yeah, so, like, her wrists are bound, and then she's, like, right up against the posts. So there should be enough slack to turn her over.
I'll tell you what I've done. I've made a little slip knot at the skinny end of the tie. Then I'm tying my wrists together on podcast. Then I've twisted it so it's not, like, really hard to get out of or whatever. I could just twist my hands around. And then the fat end of the tie can be tied to the bed. So really, it doesn't have to be a comedy-length clown tie to do what he's describing here. So there you go. All right.
Good job, Cherrydoom.
Thanks.
We did
Thanks,
it.
Everybody. Thanks, Cherrydoom, for trying your best. Also, you kind of... I just had to see it for myself.
I did it without even having a tie.
He says, shall I fuck you this way, or this way, or this way? There's an endless choice. He's not doing anything when he's saying this way, or this way, or this way. He's just breathing against her lips. He's not, like, demonstrating any multiple ways of fucking her. So I guess he's just thinking about it. But still, it's just, like, so strange. She's probably just like, what are you talking about? Or maybe he's doing something, like, some minute modification that's so fine detail that she can't even discern it.
He's some sort of, like, tantric Kama Sutra master.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe it's, like, some sort of memento scenario where he's got every single position and, like, thing ever that he's done or read about tattooed on his body, and he's, like, pointing at them to her. Should I do you this way or this way or this way? Oh, yeah, so the vibe that I got when I read this sentence was that it was very, like, Alice in Wonderland. Like, I could see, like, Cheshire Cat or, like, the Mad Hatter or Tweedledee and Tweedledum, like, shall I fuck you this way or this way or this way? An endless choice!
Also, the phrase an endless choice seems wrong.
Yeah, I agree.
It sounds like one choice that goes on forever.
Yeah, that's what it actually means.
The call dropped at this point. Can our heroes recover from this tragedy? The answer, thanks to the power of editing, is yes.
So where were we before that happens?
Chad's wording.
Alrighty.
So on page 189, we already sort of talked about this. It's the yucky, the gloriously yummy thing again. The note that I have written here is, why does E.L. James choose the worst times to lose track of her thesaurus? So page 190, his fingers circle my ear and very softly, rhythmically, he tugs my earlobe. That seems, I don't know, rhythmically tugging an earlobe seems really distracting and sort of silly. What is he doing it in rhythm to? Mambo number 5? The melody of Bad Romance? Some Skrillex song? Just think about that. Tugging on your earlobe.
It's not, it's so sexual, by the way. No, it's not. Like, okay, I'll give you this. It doesn't feel that bad. I'm doing it right now. But is not intrinsically very erotic, or is it?
I don't know. Maybe someone else is doing it. Like, you can't tickle yourself.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like, but again, like, not one of those things intrinsically, like, okay, maybe, like...
Okay. You get home from a long day of work, and you're like, oh, I'm so tired, and your significant other is like, welcome home, honey, and begins rhythmically tugging your earlobe.
Gross. Or you get home from a long day of work, you don't have a significant other. Time to tug the old earlobe. I don't think so.
Put on some headphones. Wait, no, I can't do that. Page 191. Desire. Acute. Liquid and smoldering. Some liquids do smolder. However, most normal liquids, like liquids that you'd encounter every day, the liquids that Anastasia would encounter, her quote-unquote tea, water, those things don't smolder.
What is smoldering? Like burning?
Like coal, gently?
Yes, smoldering is sort of towards the end of a fire, like when you have ashes, like coals starting to burn out.
Oh, it gives off the... Okay. But maybe the liquid of desire does in fact do this. Like, she's describing the substance of desire.
Yeah.
So, like, what I would think of as, like, a smoldering liquid would be, like, cooling lava. That's, like, the only thing I could really think of. Or, like, something... Just anything molten that's, like, starting to cool.
Well, maybe desire is a euphemism for lava. Her lava is acute liquid and smoldering.
Perhaps. So I think that's really sort of a small gripe, because I guess it's fine. So on the same page, his tongue is in my mouth, claiming and possessing me. That's just gross. I just find that gross. Like a tongue claiming and possessing her. The tongue just like gets up on her forehead and plants a little flag.
Ew.
It's like, I claim this in the name of Christian Grey.
That's a good tongue voice.
And then also on the same page, delicious things to my insides. It's just, she keeps saying delicious. And for some reason, the way that she keeps putting it, I find a little off-putting. Like, delicious is a completely fine word on its own. But up against all the other strange things in this book, and in particular, like, the relations between Anna and Christian, it just has this very, like, the oddly cannibalistic side to all of this is sort of disconcerting. Like, she's always biting her lip. Everything about her, like, sexual urges is delicious, and he's yummy. And these are all things that normal people say, but these aren't normal people, so what does this mean? Yeah, I'm not gonna read my notes, because,
I think maybe it's really funny. Your notes are funny. Well, okay, first of all, you're no longer in the trash zone because you put your notes in the dock. So I absolve you from trash zone. Maybe there was no second wall.
Oh, okay.
I did have to say about this, though, like, you I'm embarrassed. I don't know if I could say, I'm just gonna do it. You say about how there's, like, that strangely, like, cannibalistic sex vibe. Like, I don't think... That might have been subconscious on E.L. James' part, but, like, to be honest with you, like, I can kind of see that side of it. Like, there's something very, like, bizarre, consumption-y. If this was a book that was meant to take more artistic liberties, then, like, then I would kind of get it, because it would be making some kind of commentary on, like, the intricacies of sex and, like, the give-take of it.
Yeah.
Where you, like, maybe you're a little bit being considered. I don't know why I was so embarrassed to say that, but... Maybe that's because I think it's a little bit like that. I don't know.
That's an interesting perspective.
You can continue. It's not good to conflate visceral things, I agree. But it could be interesting to compare to each other. So I allow that, but I do think that it's also a bit... I think it's a little weird. I wouldn't like to write it out so obviously like that if I was her.
Yeah, I mean, like I don't... I don't find an inherent problem with this sort of wording for, you know, these sorts of things. It's just... there's something about the way that it's written in this particular book that I find off-putting, and it might just because the rest of the book is so off-putting.
Oh, believe me, I think this is very off-putting. We'll get to it in a very short time.
Page 194, impressive length. This is a thing that I think she already said before in, like,
yeah.
And she just keeps saying it.
At what point does it stop being impressive, you know? Like, you've seen it already.
It's still new. The romance is still new.
This line is hilarious, and I didn't see it the first time I was reading the chapter. In spite of my poignant sadness, I laugh. That's Anna describing her own sadness as poignant. That's extremely self-aggrandizing, like, my poignant sadness. I'm not disagreeing that it's, like, a poignant...
Well, wait a minute. Poignant just, according to this Google search I did, poignant just means evoking a keen sense of sadness or regret. So, if anything, it's redundant.
There are more subtle meanings to poignant.
Neat, skillful, and to the point. Yeah, okay. Yeah, profoundly moving and touching.
That's typically how poignant is used, is like profoundly touching. Like, she's overselling. She's being extremely melodramatic, and she's saying it about herself.
My profound sadness is touching me in my sad place.
Okay, and last, shouty capitals. I thought that was stupid.
Context, please.
Yes. So on the very last page, Anna gets an email from Christian Grey, which says, "Go to bed, Anastasia," in all caps. And she's like, oh, shouty capitals, which is just funny because apparently she's never used the internet. So I don't know how she understands all of this, like, emoticons. And I mean, I guess all text or all capital text speaks for itself. But would she have all these context cues? Is she socialized in that way? We don't know. We just don't know.
It's just not clear. So that was it for Chad, unless there was a secret that I'm not aware of. The secret I wasn't aware of. A novel by Cheeuurls. Situational. So just as an intro to this, like, this is the first time reading this whole book that I've ever been as insanely uncomfortable as this made me feel. I had to call up Helmet Condenser, who did the chapter 8 virginity reading. We went through this chapter together, so thanks for helping me get through. Helmet Condenser, shout out to you. Okay, that said, here's some other things before, because my complaints about my discomfort are gonna take up at least 5 minutes. Here we go, quote, I press send, hugging myself, laughing at my little joke. Will he find it as funny? Oh shit, probably not. Badly done piece of shit writing. Badly done piece of shit writing. It's just so bad. Like, okay, let me let you in on this. So the joke that she makes is that she doesn't want to see him anymore and that she doesn't agree. So she was like, see you never, is basically what her email's saying. And then she's like, ha ha ha! Like, so this is, again, another, maybe more proof that she's not human, because she doesn't have a human sense of humor. So note, everybody, note the blue and white motif returning. Quote, sparse white wicker furniture in a white iron double bed with a patchwork quilt made by my mother when she was in her folksy American quilting phase. It's all pale blue and cream. What do you think that this color thing that keeps coming up is meant to evoke? Because to me, it's very sterile and not at all comfortable or passionate. Like, I look at those colors and I think, like, you know, blah, not great.
I mean, that's Anna, right?
Yes, but it's also Christian.
Like, the wicker, white wicker furniture makes me think of, like, an old lady's home. And the white iron double bed.
Also, handmade quilts are very old lady-ish, yeah.
I mean, blue is obviously a big theme in this book. Like, Christian has it in his own house, and he buys Anna that bra, and Anna wears it her first day, but I don't know what the fuck it's supposed to mean.
I don't really know either. I mean, it's possible it doesn't mean anything, but clearly it has some kind of importance.
I mean, I guess it's all, like, coldness of Christian.
Yeah, but that's not very sexy. I mean, to give you an example from another book that's very good by Orhan Pamuk, it's called The Museum of Innocence, and he uses the color yellow over and over again to, like, push some feelings, like the very evocative feelings of, like, this woman that he loves and the country that he's living in. But this is, like, nothing compared to that. So I was just, if we all agreed.
Yeah, I feel like, personally, I need to get through the book to probably sort it out, because it's sort of obfuscated. It's not clear. E.L. James doesn't really have the technique and nuance to pull it off, I don't feel.
Was there a color theme like this in Twilight?
That was a good question.
Mm.
I don't know.
I can't remember there being one.
I have a question. So in the print copy, at least my print copy, does it in the PDF say American quilting phase? Because, yeah, in the print copy, it's Americana quilting phase.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, weird. Yeah, here it says American.
That's probably just I'm assuming that they just don't have the...
Well, think of it this way. So if you're an American, you wouldn't say that you have an American quilting phase. You say that you have an Americana one. Yes.
That still doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Unless she's, like, just quilting a bunch of, like there's just a bunch of road signs and, like I'm thinking of, like, Chili's style Americana.
I suppose. Okay, next thing. Anastasia Steele, are you jealous? Christian says after saying, oh, you can meet up with one of my 15 subs or Mrs. Robinson which I think he calls her Mrs. Robinson, which is weird. Like, are you? And then she's like, no, I wouldn't want to do that. And he's like, oh, you must be jealous. Like, who in the world would want to meet all your exes? Like, the, like, what is this? Is this like the second time they've ever had, you know, like a little excursion together? Like, ew, no one wants to do that. I don't want to meet your old subs and exes and your fucking former molester. That's disgusting. Also, like, that you still have a relationship with her. Or not disgusting, I'm sorry. I probably am insulting, like, everybody ever here. But, I mean, come on. Like, that is something that anybody would have a hard time with. And in fact, it would not, you would be outside the norm if you didn't have a problem with it. Am I wrong here?
Yes. I mean, no, you're not wrong.
Okay.
But, you know, some people aren't jealous for some reason.
I mean...
Well, I sort of noted this down as, like, something I liked. Not the, like, offering to meet his, like, his mentor. They obviously probably do not have a good, real, healthy relationship. Probably. It's hard to say right now. But I just meant, like, because, like, I don't think it is good in that it is a thing you should do. But in terms of, like, Christian as a character, he's obviously trying to, like, ease her into the lifestyle. And he's doing it by offering to, you know, his ex-subs can talk about it to her because they've also signed the NDA. So it's at least someone she could maybe talk to about it. So that's kind of...
That's very logical and everything, but, like, still, I mean, just...
But, and, like, from Christian's perspective, at least based on what I'm getting from this chapter, since he's not really asking for a relationship the way that Anna is thinking of it, which is part of the reason that she's so jealous, it doesn't seem like a faux pas to him, even though it really is.
I would like to draw everybody's attentions back to the whole boundary issue that we've discussed. I think that falls into that. I mean, it is a little bit different than, like, a personal boundary issue, but, like, if you're not keeping those aspects of your life separate from each other, I think that's too much overlap. I think it's inappropriate. And he even said that he was, like, you know, monogamous with his subs. So to some extent, even though it's not a traditional relationship, it is some kind of relationship. Therefore, you would not want to bring in old flames into the picture. And this becomes obvious in the second book, and that's all I have to say about that.
Like, I'm not trying to give Christian a pass here on what he's doing, but I mean, like, it seems more like he's treating this as a professional arrangement rather than, like, emotional. So in some ways, I don't feel like it's terrible. I don't know. Maybe I'm just a bad person.
Wait, about what?
Like, offering to have Anna meet one of his subs. Like, he's not really bringing someone else into the relationship in a relationship sense. He's doing this as, like, an arrangement to be like, well, do you want to just talk to somebody that's got, like, experience with me as a dom? Like, do you want a reference, basically? And so, like, in that regard, especially because Anna's so green, that seems like a nice thing for him to do, even because he's not thinking of it.
I would say if this was more of a scene, BDSM scene, yeah, that would be fine.
Yeah, like if they were in a
like
club
that,
and
that's what I think. That's how I think how he's approaching it.
Yeah,
I think,
that's what I'm thinking.
And that's like there's a mismatch here, like between the way that they're thinking about it.
I mean, it should be very obvious to the three of us that they are not in any kind of scene. They're doing this together on their own. So in that case, to bring in some new people is very... a highly suspect thing. It needs to be done with care. And even though this is, you know, a business arrangement, which clearly, you know, Christian wants it to be, there is an undercurrent of, like, I don't know what you want to call it, romance, care, personal care.
Yeah.
So, you know, you need to be, Christian needs to be aware of that and not evoke all these other women that he's slept with, you know? It's...
Well, he's sort of a bad person. Yeah. I mean, I have some of this in, like, safe word later if we would like to talk about it at length more there or something. Sort of the mismatch between their perceptions of what sort of arrangement they're getting into, and also the fact that Christian is probably, like, he's admitted he hasn't ever related to anybody in a traditional romance arrangement sort of way. So from his perspective, this is the only way that he really knows how to relate to another individual.
I don't know. We're probably talking a little bit too much about it, to be honest.
Yeah, maybe.
I don't know. Let's leave it for later, I think. Anyways, I don't like it. Next, quote. Oh, I meant to say, Kate says, your dad called when you were, occupied. Apparently Bob has sustained some injury, so your mom and he can't make graduation. But your dad will be here Thursday. He wants you to call. Like, okay, and then it's just like, oh, all right. Like, nobody gives a shit that Bob has sustained an injury. Like, why didn't you call Bob to make sure he was okay? Like, what if he had a fucking heart attack? Like, oh, yeah, fine. It was just, like, a really easy way to get the stepdad and the mom out of the situation, which is weird. I don't know why she needed to do that.
Yeah, I was also wondering that.
Like, I must go. I am injured. My home planet can only be the one that cures me, says Bob. And so I've left the best for last. and maybe not the best, but the angriest and the longest. Here we go. So I'd like to read to you a couple passages that evoke the way that Anastasia must be feeling during the course of this little sex encounter. So here we go. I don't know why I glance up. Maybe I catch a slight movement from the corner of my eye. I don't know. But when I do, he's standing in the doorway of my bedroom, watching me intently. He's wearing his gray flannel pants and a white linen shirt, gently twirling his car keys. I pull out my earbuds and freeze. I glance around the room, plotting an escape route. No, there's still only the door or window. Somehow he moves. I have no idea how, and in the blink of an eye, I'm on the bed, pinned beneath him, my arms stretched out and held above my head, his free hand clutching my face, and his mouth finds mine. There's another quote here, but I'm gonna read it later. He doesn't stop. I'm spent. I can't take this. And he pounds on and on. Then I'm building again. Surely not. No. And then, after the sex. For the first time, I'm wishing he was normal, wanting a normal relationship, that doesn't need a 10-page agreement and all kinky BDSM stuff. Dot, dot, dot. I continue. I feel like a receptacle, says Anastasia, an empty vessel to be filled at his whim. He asks her if she's okay, though in all honesty, she's just not sure. I feel a paradigm shift. I know that if I do this thing with him, I will get hurt. He's not capable, interested, or willing to offer me anymore. Later on, she closes the door, she leans against it. She can't rationalize her feelings, and she just cries. I mean, I understand that there was probably some consensualness about this. Like, I'm not going to say that this was sexual assault, but at the same time, like, they haven't signed any contracts. All he asks her to do is to trust him. He doesn't tell her what's going to happen. And then he, like, does all this stuff to her, and then, like, you know, he goes and she has, like, this, like, emotional outpouring because, like, she can't handle it. Like, this is not, you know, something was done wrong here on Christian's part. Something was maybe also done wrong here on Anna's part. I don't know if I can put all the culpability on him. She needs to not let herself get into these situations. All right, well, everybody else can now say their things. Go on ahead.
So she says no at some point. It's when he's taking off her shoes, and it's, you know, she's worried about her stinky feet.
Yeah.
Does this count? I mean, they're not in any sort of, okay. They're not in any sort of, you know, contract or understanding, really, of right now, except
right.
that he said he trusts her. I mean, does this count as non-consent? I mean,
Maybe.
I mean, she's obviously not consenting to have her shoes taken off.
To me, it seems like she thought that he was going to do, like, the foot stuff to her again, like, gumming her feet. And that's kind of what she was saying no to. And indeed, he does not do that. He just, like, takes them off.
That's true. Okay.
So that's sort of what I thought that was.
All right. That makes sense. I think that's all I have to say about that. Okay, yeah. Christian goes out of the room with no shirt on to talk to Kate, which is super weird and really, I don't know, like, I mean, Kate knows they're fucking, but I would find that really, okay, I'm an awkward person, but if, like, someone came out of the room and was, like, making it really known that they were gonna fuck my roommate, I would be weirded out.
I think it depends on many things.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like both that he was doing it to humiliate her or to, like, lord it over Kate, that, you know, hey, I know you've been trying to dom Anna, but look at me, I have my shirt off and we're about to fuck.
Maybe they were just finally finishing the terms of their arrangement together.
Oh yeah, maybe. of giving it a...
Like, the plan's set in motion. I'm doing it now.
Pop the wine. Let's have a drink. We did it.
So they have, like, a victory drink, and then he goes back to do the thing. Sort of.
Yeah.
I actually have a theory about this later that we can talk about. I mean, I could do it now. The weird sex that Christian is having was all a ploy for Kate to swoop in and be the rebound. As per my theory that Kate and Christian are trading off Anastasia. Kate is trying to get one last fuck in, and then that was like a part of the agreement. Like, you can have one last thing. I'll throw you this bone, and then I'll take control of Anastasia completely. But it didn't quite work out that way. You know, Kate is comforting her, but she couldn't quite push it to the next level, as it were. And now Kate and Christian have to think up a new way to appease Kate and, you know, have it be worth it. You know, sort of like a dowry. He's paying her a dowry in sex. But now they have to think of something else.
So he does a predicament type of situation with the line on her body. Predicament bondage is kind of a cool thing.
Yeah, okay. I thought that was not a bad thing to do. I think that based on somebody's, Helmut Knezer's reaction, when I was reading it with him, you know, that's not a very... I'm surprised that this book is not more like a general... It doesn't try to appeal generally to people in BDSM. It seems like they want to go more for, like, niche things, maybe just based on what the author likes, which is fine. But I just find it interesting. You would think that it would be a little bit more, I guess, well-rounded out.
I don't know. I don't think... What do you mean niche? Like, are you saying that predicament bondage is niche?
No, no. I'm saying that, like, specifically, like, the sort of body fluid thing, like, because, like, okay, Anastasia really likes the wine because it's been in his mouth already. I believe there's a section, a passage that says that. And also, right. Just, like, I don't know what the term for this is, temperature play.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, okay, good. Yeah, not everybody likes that or finds it, like, super sexy. It's, you know, for some people, you put an ice cube on them and they just are like, yeah, whatever. I would put myself in that category. I don't really care. So, like, I guess it just brings me back to the original thought, like, why is she writing this? Is she doing it to, like, write something that's going to appeal to people, or is she just doing it for herself? I don't know. Hard to say. That's my thought.
I mean, I feel like she's probably going to put in a lot of things for a lot of different people. For instance, when you're writing fanfiction, you might want to have these two characters do a lot of things. Some people really want to see some predicament bondage. Some people really want to see he's using her as a footstool, so she'll put that in, like, one chapter or something like that.
If that's the case, then she is kind of alienating some fetish havers, because, like, I believe we've gotten to the point where she says no suspension bondage. Have we gotten to that?
No.
Or like, caning. She's like, oh my god, like, don't cane me. Or, like, she says, you know, certain things are so fucked up. And so I feel like that's not very inclusive.
That's true.
Just the thought. That's it.
So he he withdraws his hand and reaches over to the bedside table for a foil packet. She talk about him putting the condoms on the table?
I don't think so.
Were they just there?
Maybe when she was blindfolded, he put them there?
Maybe he doesn't actually reach for condoms. He's just reaching for, like, a packet of, like, trading card foils, like Pokemon cards or something.
Yes, this holographic Charizard will protect us, baby.
Oh, he's not using it for anything. He's just admiring the cards.
Yes. I did such a good trade that one time.
I mean, I guess there's a lot of condom stuff. This is, like, the second time condom stuff has happened while she couldn't see, I guess.
It's good to push protection, though. It's nice that they're having protected sex. I was about to say, I had a traumatic memory suddenly pop up about holographic Pokemon cards. I traded my fucking holographic Blastoise for a fucking Professor Oak imposter card because my friend lied to me and said that I could take it to the store and trade it in for a Charizard or something really dumb like that.
Wow, what a jerk.
I fucking hate you, you dumb kid.
I had a first edition Charizard that I traded away under false pretenses.
Uh-oh. I'm so sorry.
I traded my copy of Pokemon Blue for Gex 3D.
Oh no, God. That's the worst story. You win.
You win.
Somebody needs to apologize for Gex.
So she talks about feeling like a receptacle, an empty vessel to be filled on a whim. My subconscious shakes her head. You wanted to run to the Heathman for sex. You had it express delivered. She crosses her arms and taps her foot with a what are you complaining about look on her face. First of all, I think that she could have explained the facial expression better than, like, what she might be saying if she was saying something.
Yeah. I really don't like this part with the subconscious. Her subconscious is trying to guilt her.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, she's guilting herself, essentially, but it's very strange, and, like, I mean, probably something that a lady does a lot.
I mean, I could point out the obvious and say, like, no kidding she's complaining, because the sex wasn't really on her own terms, you know?
True, yeah.
Yeah.
She still had a great time, though, apparently.
Apparently.
Until he, like, left immediately afterwards, even though she said, I'm tired now and I'm going to bed. He's not capable, interested, or willing to offer me any more, and I want more. Okay. So far, like, he keeps saying it, but everything he's done is very boyfriendy.
Yeah, it is.
He's had sex with her. He's, like, taken her out to dinner.
I disagree. He's extremely emotionally closed off, and she basically wants emotional fulfillment and validation, and he's not giving that to her, and that's what she wants. Like, it's basically the complete opposite of, like, what she would probably want out of a normal relationship.
Guess what, Chad? I disagree! Yes, in some ways he is emotionally closed off, and yet in other ways he's very doting on her. Like, in the ways that...
Yeah, and he's always like, what are you doing to me? You're so sexy.
Anastasia is just not aware that if she merely asked him, because, like, I think really part of the reason she was so upset is that, like, she probably wanted him to stay, like, the night. So if she had said, like, I need you to stay the night, like, I need you to, then he probably would have said, like, yes, and he would have stayed. It's kind of a classic thing where I think if she was like me, in other words, if she had dated other people before, she would kind of know, like, is it playing a game? I don't think it is, to kind of, like, push the relationship forward a little bit and say, like, hey, like, why don't you stay, you know? And then suddenly you find yourself in the arrangement that you want, provided you keep, you know, communicating and maybe doing those small things. Does this make me sound like a crazy person?
I just think that Christian wouldn't agree. Like, I think that if she had asked for any of that, he would have just said no.
Why don't we find out next chapter? Why don't we find out next chapter? See who's right. Let's see who's right.
Well, gee, I wonder what that means.
Well, jeez! No, actually, I don't know. What if I'm being hilarious and it's actually a reverse psychology thing and you are right?
Okay, so Kate says, what did he do to you? And she says, oh, Kate, nothing I didn't want him to. First of all, like, the phrase, oh, Kate, followed by that sentence is just, like, so very literary, I guess. Like, you would only see that in a book, I feel like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No one would say that.
Okay, wait, sorry. Can I want to say one more thing about the last, like, the thing above, like, the not capable
sure.
thing. Both of you, I mean, I know he's been doting, and it's obvious that he's interested in her, but, like, contrast that against, like, what he did with, like, offering, oh, do you want to meet one of my exes? And, like, what you were talking about, Cheeuurls, about how that creeped you out. Like, seriously? I mean, obviously
yes,
he doesn't
I
have...
agree that that is definitely a thing where, you know, he is seeing this on terms of merely a sexual relationship. And so, you know, oh, it's fine if someone else I've had sex with talks to her.
I think it's misguided solving of the situation.
Yeah.
Because he's not aware, like, he hasn't had, like, that type of relationship where you do have to be sensitive to that, then he may not necessarily know. Like, I think in his previous relationships, this would have been fine. But, you know, just because it's only a sexual relationship doesn't mean that there's not some level of care in there. So, that's what I have to say.
I don't know, and maybe this is just because I am not good at having emotional relationships with people, but, like, I don't know, it seems like, what else would they be doing other than, like, having dinner, talking about, you know, their relationship, having sex?
Well, here's what I have to say.
Communicating.
I mean, yes, it has many of the hallmarks of, like, a dating relationship, but really what separates it from a real relationship is the level of commitment that you can expect out of it. So, like, for certain things, she has a support, especially anything sexual. You know, there's the whole money aspect of it as well. That does kind of seem a little bit more like a, you know, traditional, whatever you think traditional is, relationship. Some other things, like, because he basically has the right to turn her down if she needs emotional support for something. That's the difference between a real relationship and a fake relationship. Or not a fake one. Sorry, that is so rude. A real emotional relationship and one that is just for sex. It is literally the same. Like, what is friends with benefits as opposed to a boyfriend? And I guess that's a question everybody needs to think about themselves. But to me, that's like, the boyfriend is committed to me.
But he is committed to her. He's not gonna...
But emotionally...
I guess there's nothing in the...
I don't know.
There's nothing in the thing about him being exclusive, I guess.
But he says that. He had said earlier that it was. But it is not in the... Actually, no, it is. Okay, so there's no sharing of the sub. And the Dom will not... I believe it says the Dom will not pursue other... relationships or go with other subs or anything. Yeah, something we could probably discuss more in depth a little later. Sorry, I was getting a little bit long-winded there.
Oh, that's my fault.
My bad.
Right, and his stepdad is hurt, so great, he could not be in the thing at the graduation for some reason. I can hold off on that. On introducing two new characters, maybe. I don't know if that's why or what. Okay, this is in Anna's, we haven't really talked about these yet, but in her, concerns about the contract. A lot of them are, like, very naive. Like, why is this in here? You know I don't do this. Like, it's a pretty standard contract. Like, it's not just for you, obviously. Maybe, I don't know. Like, it's clearly not tailored to simply her own needs, so. She's like, touching myself without your permission. What's the problem with this? You know I don't do it anyway.
Do we want to talk about this a little bit?
Well, yeah, sure.
Why was the book this way, that she didn't ever do that?
I would say more of a blank slate so that she can, like, you know, discover all of this with him.
Possibly to make her more unbelievable.
But yeah, that's how I feel. But perhaps if you were Christian or Dom, you would probably want your sub to regularly do that anyways, because then if you take something away, it becomes more titillating to have them only get it from you. So if she doesn't do it in the first place, it's like, what's the fucking point?
I mean, I think that's just, like, a standard thing that he would put in his contract for any sub. He doesn't...
Right, but...
I'm not sure how he would even know that she didn't touch herself. I don't think they've ever talked about it, except that maybe she hasn't had an orgasm before.
Oh, no, because when they were...
There's some sort of, like, little tag, like a bracelet, and then there's, like, a little skin, like, something inserted right around, like, her thigh, so that if she's approaching it, it goes off, and an alarm sets off, and, like, an elite task force bursts in through her windows and immediately whisks her off to Christian's torture room.
Whoa. What was I going to say about this? Now I don't remember. I feel really sad.
I'm sorry.
Oh, yes. I actually remember that did happen. So when they're first having sex for the first time, he's like, show me how you do it. And she's like, what do you mean? So there you go. Okay. I believe we're onto Chad's stuff.
The only one that's ever touched Anna before this is Kate, apparently. And just her hair. Just brushing her hair. She's just like, yeah, now I want to feel like brushing your hair. And that's it. That's the whole thing. That's all I got to say. All right. Anyway. So page 187, first page of the chapter. I plug in my iPod. Oh, that's a fine sentence, but she's plugging in her headphones to listen to her music. She's not plugging her iPod into anything, I assume.
No, that's correct. That's a correct assumption. She's plugging in the headphones so she can go running.
Yeah, I just feel like E.L. James doesn't know.
What she doesn't know where she is or what she's doing.
Yeah. No, E.L. James is lost in a void. Page 188. Why is Kate wearing sarongs?
I'll tell you, because she's going to the Bermudas. I know. She's actually not going to the Bermudas. Please remind me.
No, she's going to Barbados.
Yes, she's going to Barbados. God damn it.
Which is not where sarongs originate from.
Of course not, but it's just beachwear.
Yeah, it's like a sheer scarfy thing that you tie around your waist. It's like a beach skirt.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess I was thinking of the wrong type of sarong then.
It's very elegant. Yeah, there are different types of sarongs.
Yeah, I was thinking of a traditional dress wear from a different country.
No, not okay. That kind.
But still, why is she doing it? And that's all I have to say about that. Page 193. It tastes all the more divine because it's been in his mouth. That's gross. That's gross.
Yeah, see, this is what I was talking about.
I disagree. I mean, I agree that not everybody thinks it's cool.
Some people do. I agree. I accept that some people think it's cool.
I would be probably pretty grossed out if someone did it to me, but I like doing it to other people.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense. How do I put this? I mean, to me, I mean, hey, here we go. Perfect sample group. Chad doesn't like it. I'm very ambivalent. Cherrydoom likes it. There you go. Just goes to show you how much people will be different.
Actually, I'm not saying this as like a practice that I would or would not enjoy, because I have no idea. I just mean in terms of like the actual... writing.
I'm sorry.
Like, I don't have any particular feeling about this either way in real life. But, like, in terms of the book, I think it's gross.
We should probably say what exactly.
Yeah.
Means. Yes. So at this point, Christian has the wine and he is passing it from his mouth into Anna's after sipping it.
This is called baby birding, by the way. Some circles.
In some circles, in some special circles.
All right. In particular with liquids, it's not so bad. Especially alcohol, because there would just be like no indication.
Yeah, it's but
like,
sterile.
Well, alcohol's not sterile. But,
no, but you know.
Yeah.
Compared to like a cheeseburger.
If you had like a bacon cheeseburger from Wendy's covered in like mayo, and you're like, that would be pretty gross. It's like bacon bits falling all over Anna's chest and stuff. Little bits of burger bun.
No, Chad!
If you spill the grease on the bed, Anna, I'm gonna have to get out the fries. That's all I have to say about that. So from like 193 to like 194, 195, Anna, and this is pretty understandable given Anna's complete inexperience, but I just think like, given the circumstances, she would be trying to exercise a lot more self-control over her own reactions, trying like not to do anything at all so as not to incur the wrath of Christian, a thing she has no sense for the depths of his retaliation in terms of like what he will do if she disobeys. So I think in this circumstance, probably someone like Anna would just, you know, be as still as possible.
Well, I don't think you understand here. Anastasia has basically been set up to fail in this situation because that is sexy. Do you get that? Like, I'm sure that you do.
Is this a real thing that you're saying?
Or yes, are you saying, this like, is a real thing that book? I'm saying. I mean, sure, the book as well. I mean, like, no, the reason that she's, you know, squirming and stuff is that he's given her a task that she's not going to be able to do. It's like a BDSM thing. Somebody help me here. It's predicament. So the fact that she's getting stimulation that she cannot control how her body will react to it, in other words, she's like, you know, wiggling and stuff, and the fact that she also can't let the stuff spill, she's meant not to have control over it.
Well, I understand that. However,
you think that she would or that she should?
No, I don't think that she would. Because again, she's like, I mean, it's the sort of thing that you could like train yourself to have self-control under these sorts of circumstances.
I mean, what I'm kind of trying to say is that, okay, Anna can't do this.
Yeah, Anna wouldn't be able to.
But I think that you would be hard pressed to find somebody who could.
But I mean, she's not like, I understand the that it's designed for her to fail, but it doesn't seem like she's trying to succeed at all anyway. Like, that's what I mean.
Right, she's not like, trying.
I'm not trying to criticize her for failing, because that's obviously what's supposed to happen. I'm just saying, like based on how it's set up, I'm just saying, like, it never is there any indication in Anna's internal monologue that she's resisting. Like, I she's see. Not trying to comply with what's going on. She just reflexively moves her hips, like, without any... She's, like, she's not trying to control herself in any way.
Right, okay. Now it is a little bit more
There's
clear.
No restraint. That's what I'm saying. Like, okay. I'm not trying to criticize her for... Yeah, sorry if it sounded the other way.
It's okay. They're just making it clear for everybody here.
Yep. And on the same page, like 194, 193, I hear him smile. No, you don't, Anna. You don't hear him smile.
Well, what about this? Impossible. All right, listen to this. That's a laugh, I'm sorry. But some people, when they smile, they make a little, like, you know, they make a little breath noise when they smile.
I was thinking of the tooth sparkle, like the ding.
I'm smiling right now, guys. That's the sound of my smile.
Does that happen every time you smile?
You tell me.
Never smile again.
That's me frowning.
Oh, that's a frown. What's the frustration noise other than, like, tittering and babbling?
It's screaming.
Page 194. His tongue mirrors the actions of his fingers, claiming me. Cheuurls mentioned this earlier, where it sounds like the tongue is mirroring the actions of his hands, which because of an agreement error, but also based on, like, what he's doing, I think, in the actual what is implied here, where he's, like, fingering her and then also doing a thing with his tongue in her mouth, I don't think it makes sense.
Grabbing tongue.
Okay, so the thing that he's doing with his fingers, I think, is, like, he's penetrating her. And I think, like, moving him in and out, and then circling her clitoris with his thumb, and then pressing down on it. So, like, what is his tongue doing? Is it, like, is he just, like, flipping it all around in her mouth and, like, occasionally poking her in the tongue?
Of course.
Like, what's going on here? He's, like, going back to, like, her uvula and, like, grabbing it, like, pretending it's the clit or something?
I'm super duper confused. See, I thought this was from something else. Like, you know, when he's pulling her hair off her head, scoops her hair off her head.
Yeah, well, that's, like, that was the agreement error, but, like, he's supposed to be implying that, like what he's doing with his fingers to stimulate her down there is he's also doing with her tongue in her mouth.
Oh, because he has two hands. Yeah, but that's...
It doesn't make any sense. Like, there's not really a way, unless he were just, you know, like, circling his fingers around or something.
I thought he was scooping her in her mouth, scooping with his tongue. But no. He was doing the other thing. Fingering her mouth with his tongue.
Yes. Thank you, E.L. James. Please cut that entire thing. It was very embarrassing.
No, never.
Page 196. So this is just, like, a description of what's actually happening. Like, this is right after he enters Anna and she has all of her orgasms. And then she's, like, on the brink. And then Christian's like, oh, yeah, do that thing again that you do or whatever. And then she comes again and she, like, screams his name and... Like, obviously they're making a lot of noise, and Kate, there's, like, no way Kate doesn't know what's going on. But Anna's like, does she know? I don't really think there's a way that she could have avoided it, unless she was just, like, submerged in the bath or something. then on the next page, that was really nice, I whisper, smiling coyly. I'm not really sure how she can be coy here.
I think it is because of the nice motif. She's, like, making a coy reference to that.
I see. Then on the same page, 196. So there's an exchange of dialogue here where they're talking about Anna's use of the word nice. Anna says, it seems to have a very beneficial effect on you. And Christian's response is, I'm a beneficial effect, now am I? And that's not what Anastasia said at all. Like, that's totally wrong.
Yeah, I had that underlined too. And then I thought about it and I was thinking maybe, like, he's saying the me now that you see here is the beneficial effects, not the normal me.
Then I think that's what he's trying to say, but...
Well, thinking about it, he was the beneficial effect on himself because she said it, and then it caused him to change himself to do something else. That is a crazy line of logic that you have to get on.
Yeah, what did he actually change?
He
just showed up creepily at her house and decided to have his way with her.
The value of fucking was changed from 0 to 1. That's what changed.
But, like, what about his personality changed there?
I don't really know.
So, like, see, that's what I mean.
He's saying that he doesn't have a personality to her. He's just the beneficial effect of...
Either way, that's not what she really said, and I don't understand his line of logic.
I can only read this, by the way, in him responding in a really, like, a fat voice, a fat, ugly English voice. I'm a beneficial effect now, am I? I just can't. I hope that you all enjoyed that, because I can't stop thinking about it.
Oh, yes. Okay, page 200. Kate is about to comfort Anna. She's found Anna weeping on the floor. So Kate, she pulls me to my bed and we sit, which is a little gross because that's the bed where she and Christian were just having sex and there's been no cleanup or anything.
However, you say in your notes that it's an uncovered bed. It's not. He tucks Anastasia in afterwards. So the covers are on the bed.
Oh, okay.
The stank is contained. I mean, the quilt is covering part of it.
The image of, like, someone who just fucked you, like, tucking you into bed and then leaving it is really bothering me.
It could be that she pulled all the sheets off, like, to wash them, and so there's no gross danger.
They're sitting on a mattress now? Yeah.
I mean, I guess there's no way to hide it.
There's also wine on the bed.
I'm surprised you guys are so... Well, maybe you're not, but you seem a little surprised that roommates are... like that? I don't know.
They have sex? I don't think it's that surprising.
I don't think it's surprising. I just think, like...
The only time I ever would really get upset would be, like, if I... Oh, God. Sorry, whoever I'm talking about, whose names I won't mention. If I walk in the house and your door is open and you're doing things, that's when I start getting very upset and uncomfortable. But otherwise, I don't really care.
I have a friend who had a roommate who was on the spectrum, legitimately on the spectrum. He had, like, spreadsheets of every time he could hear my friend having sex with his girlfriend. I don't know, like, what they look like. I'm kind of curious, like, to see, like, what exactly he categorized. I think it was maybe, like, time and stuff like that.
Time elapsed.
I don't know, very strange. But yeah.
Really cool. If only I had the drive to do things like that, that'd be really funny.
I hope I haven't been misunderstood here.
No, I don't think you have been. I think Anastasia and Christian are gross. I'm definitely not disagreeing with that. But I do think that, generally speaking, as far as, like, etiquette goes, like, roommates, I think they tend to be pretty good about that stuff. Like, I would never...
No, I just mean, like, wallowing in their fluids.
Oh.
If the bed has not been changed. Like, sitting down on the bed, like, it's wet.
Ew, what?
Yeah, that's because I don't know, like...
What do you think happens?
What do you mean? What are you talking about? They sit down on her bed right after the fucking...
But do you think, like, do you think that a fuck puddle emerges every single time that people have sex?
No, not necessarily. But Anna was apparently, like, multiple orgasming from, like, Christian's, like...
It's cooties, all right? Just
okay, general, I agree with cooties, but Chad cooties, is saying okay. A puddle, and I don't agree. I don't agree with the puddle
presence. I'm confused.
Because you said, like...
We don't know anything about...
Maybe she's a squirter.
Well, I believe they would say something about it if that was... I'm so grossed out right now. Plus, they use a condom, so there's no, like, jizz. Jews.
Well, yeah, I...
There's no jizz.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for having the dirtiest mind.
You don't. Anyways, let's go on.
Okay, page 201. Anna, like, 3 or 4 times throughout the chapter, she feels the need to explain the email. Like, I send it as a joke. Will he take it as a joke?
Because he wouldn't fucking believe her. He was like, oh, okay, never mind, I'll back off.
Yeah, once she explains it.
Fucking her.
No, like, internally, she explains this about the email to herself, like, to the reader.
Maybe because she doesn't understand why it's happening. It's like, why is he doing this?
Well, let me get the, like, actual quote that I'm thinking of. Patiently, I explain the essence of the email without giving anything away. And then Kate is like, oh, so you thought he'd reply by email, which is a thing that has been said in Anna's internal monologue, like, 3 times before this. Like, I wrote it as a joke. I thought he'd reply by email. Never expected him to show up. And she's like, I explained it to Kate. And Kate's going like, ah, yes, I see. You expected him to reply by email. Like, that... the rote, like, repetition there, I don't like
email.
It.
Email.
Yeah, so Kate puts on, like, a cheesecake bikini fashion show for Anna as soon as she gets home from running.
This ties into my theory, by the way. So Kate is putting on this bikini show so that Anastasia will be tempted. But it's not working. She's already too entrenched in her heterosexual romance. Bummer. Book could be, like, 1,000% more gay. That's a literal number. A literal percentage of how much more gay it could be.
I find Kate extremely self-centered in this chapter. Only, but not all the time. But, like, so to deflect from having to talk about Christian, Anastasia is like, oh, so I mentioned Elliot. And then immediately Kate's like, oh, Elliot, oh, blah, 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 blah. And she just completely just drops talking about Christian entirely. Like, she came in, she walked in on Anna crying, and, like, Anna was obviously in distress, but all Anna had to do was go, oh, what about Elliot? And Kate's like, ah, yes, let me tell you all about Elliot. Like, there's a couple times where Kate's like, yeah, that creepy Christian, I knew there was a thing with him, but oh, Elliot. Like, that's as soon as, like, Elliot's brought up, she just stops caring about any of that stuff. And she's still not trying to, like, convince Anna not to do anything with him, despite what she's just walked in on.
I don't know. I think that, if anything, Kate is being self-centered because of bad writing. Because when I try to comfort my friends, especially if, like, because Anastasia cannot give that much information, I think she is mentioning the NDA a lot in her internal monologue. So I think maybe Kate, sensing that, could then, you know, share her feelings at the moment, which usually you would say you'd share, like, your feelings that are sad, but of course her couple feelings are not sad feelings. So it's sort of like misguided commiseration, or whatever you say.
It's like the opposite of commiseration, for her to immediately become giddy about
it. But that wasn't the goal, is what I'm trying to say. She's trying to commiserate. I'm like, oh, aren't we both happy about our relationships? Like, isn't there good things? But then Kate, you know, I just want Kate to be good, but...
But how does that just doesn't gel with, like, she was obviously comforting Anna over this Christian thing, and then also, like, he's creepy, and, like, what's this deal with, like, he just came over here to have sex with you and, like, have his way with you, and then he's like, oh, but Elliot, yeah, I'm happy now.
I just don't know. I think that it's not that crazy of a response, though. Like, if you push the focus onto other people, they tend to talk about themselves.
Would you do that if you had walked in on somebody that was, like, crying to themselves after having sex with somebody?
No. But again, I believe that's bad writing. It's from the author's inability to realize that if you walk in on someone crying, you shouldn't react like that if you're a character in a book. I'm sure that E.L. James would not do this in real life if she was in Kate's position.
Yeah, I agree. I agree that it's mostly bad writing.
Yeah, that's my thought about it. Favorite line time. I had two because I couldn't choose. I don't remember reading about nipple clamps in the Bible. Perhaps you were taught from a modern translation. Stupid. Okay, the next quote. He stares down at me for a moment, measuring my need. The need has to be 1.932 centimeters. But right now it's only 1.929. And so we're gonna have to redo the measure. It's just so stupid. How do you measure need? How do you measure her need? Is it centimeters? Is it cubic square foot? Is it liquid centimeters? I don't know. I'm not a scientist, but help me here. How do you measure need?
It could be, well, I mean, obviously.
Well, probably in force, like force applied, if you're, like, needing something.
I was going to ask if he was measuring the desire, which is, like, some kind of smoldering liquid.
Oh, also, as a note, dear listeners, the voice, when Cheeseburger is doing their own voice, that was not part of the quote.
Yes, if that wasn't clear. All right, that was mine.
We've talked about this one several times, but mine is, his other hand scoops my hair off of my head.
It's good every time you read it, though. Scoop!
Just a nice bowl of hair ice cream.
He scoops it up and puts it right on a waffle cone.
Okay, and mine is, in spite of my poignant sadness, I laugh.
That one is also a good line, for reasons we discussed. But it sounds very goth as well. Or not goth, but, you know, like, taking yourself too seriously as a teenager. My poignant sadness, yet I laugh!
She's got her sad side, but she's got her humorous side.
Now it's time for Goddess Watch. We only need one line, and it's the one that Cherrydoom chose because I'm convinced by this one line about what's to do with the level.
My inner goddess glows so bright she could light up Portland.
Warning, inner goddess is going nuclear.
The amount of energy that is needed to light up Portland is a dangerous amount of energy to exist in one goddess. It implies that her powers are growing, so I think we need to raise the level!
Raise it.
It's gonna be bright Portland gray. So trendy. No, let's have a discussion about what was good. I didn't really have anything. First, I said that Kate was a good friend, but obviously that's not true.
I'm sorry. Sorry for crushing your dreams of Kate.
No, it wasn't really a dream, honestly. It was a nightmare. I hate everything about the chapter. Okay, fine. I found one thing. I think it's funny how in the last Shouty Capital email, Christian signs his name as Christian Gray, CEO and control freak, Gray Enterprises Holdings Incorporated. I like the little efforts to try to make things funny in the emails, even though they're, like, really corny. Also, I think we should note for our listeners that Christian always signs his emails Christian Gray, CEO, Gray Enterprises Holdings Incorporated, which is really dorky.
Yeah, I have not... Well, it's not dorky, it's just how he signs... It's just, like, an automatic signature.
If this were a real joke, Christian would have actually changed his title to CFO, Control Freak Officer, put that in parens, of Grey Enterprises Holdings.
Yeah, that would have been a better joke.
Too bad you're not Christian.
No one's Christian. He's a fictional character.
True that, my friend. Cherrydoom.
Okay, she's talking about the contract. She's thinking about it. She says, my research has told me that legally it's unenforceable. He must know that. I figure that it just sets up the parameters of the relationship. I think it's good that she included this, just in case people who didn't know about contracts mm-hmm. were wondering.
In fact, I think I yelled at Chad last episode for him thinking that it was a legally binding contract. So, sorry, Chad.
Yeah, it's okay.
Let's see, I talked about that baby birding was a thing I liked, and I didn't expect it to be in this book.
Can you talk more about it? So it is, it's like a, just in case people don't know, it's like a kind of, it's a power play thing. The Dom does it, usually, I would expect.
Yeah, it's sort of like, okay, so I mean, basically what it is, you drink something, and then you hold it in your mouth, and then you, like, let it go into their mouth, either through kissing or just, like, pouring mm-hmm. it out of your mouth into their mouth. I should not admit to liking this. But, I mean, yeah, it's just kind of like a dependence kind of thing. Like, feeding someone with, like,
an eyedropper.
Oh, like you would a bird. Yeah, of course. Okay. Like, I read a scene in a basically like a BDSM instruction manual once, so about someone describing feeding someone else, but not like with their mouth, but just like, you know, picking up a spoon and putting it in their mouth. Like, having them, like, depending on you to give them the food and, like, having to wait for them to do it is very power play.
Definitely power play. I agree.
Please do not worry about the grossness, for you see, think about how gross I am. I have admitted to being a boy, the grossest thing you can be.
Boy.
Let's see, she talks about in her email to Christian about her concerns about the contract. She says, regarding Clause 2, which is about this being, okay, not sure why this is solely for my benefit, i.e. to explore my sensuality and limits. I'm sure I wouldn't need a 10-page contract to do that. Surely this is for your benefit. Which is exactly what we were talking about last chapter, and realized it.
Good for her. She realized something. Good for you, Anastasia. Yeah.
So, I originally put down that I liked the Christian, like, offering to have someone talk to Anna about the BDSM stuff. But in light of what we discussed, I have changed my opinion, like a dirty flip-flopper. And so it is now gone from the notes, which none of you can see forever.
But be assured that they exist.
Well, yes, the notes do exist. But not that note, because I just deleted it. I also, we talked about, we touched on Anna's sort of realization in this chapter about the sort of the problems she's starting to see with the relationship. And I liked that she had such extreme, like, feelings about that, like her regret about her actions and her sexual relationship with Christian. Like, it's not that I like that it's happening. In a sense, I do, because it highlights the problems with that sort of a thing, but not, it's not a good thing in and of itself. Because, like, to me, it's very obvious that Anna is being used, especially, like, right now. And this also ties into sort of the reasons I don't think, like, when you were expressing confusion over, like, well, how's he not being, like a boyfriend? And I'll talk about that a little bit later. And she's, like, she's recognizing right here and right now in an extremely real way that she's basically being used. And I think I'm guessing that that's probably the reason that she felt so, you know, like an empty vessel, as she put it, because she felt like she was an object that Christian was just using and discarding. And she's finally getting a sense of, like, the true dynamic, the power imbalance between them. And it's not just existing in the Dom sub relationship. It's sort of how Christian is. Like, it's his raison d'etre. He has this need to, like, keep and possess and conquer and, like, rule things. And he's expressed that. He basically said that in the initial interview. And it's, like, really unhealthy if that's how he wants to live his entire life. And it's going to affect Anna, and it is affecting her. And if he has suffered this other trauma that we've discussed, that's not going to help either. And he's basically just going to be inflicting more pain on other people, and he's not taking any responsibility for it. And in a way that he's also controlling it is that people aren't allowed to talk about it. So it's, like, extremely, he's basically covered all of his bases using all of the power he has available at his fingertips to ensure he never loses his power. And that is part of the reason that I think he's not a great boyfriend. Like, he's obviously, he wants to possess Anna, you know?
Yeah, so, of course.
Like,
well, the thing is, I think that Anna could be, I can't believe I'm saying this. I'm such a gross person. She could equally use him the way that he is using her, but she's not doing it either because she doesn't know how, or she doesn't think that it's ethically okay.
She's not a bad person.
Maybe I'm a bad person, okay? Maybe I am.
I mean,
but I don't care. I don't give a single shit.
Like, I'm not saying you're a bad person, but is it really, like, it's sort of like fighting fire with fire? Like, is that the appropriate response? Like, escalation or...
Well, not exactly, but just like, okay, if you are in what is essentially a business relationship where there's a give and take, and he is mostly taking, maybe you should start taking some stuff back, okay?
Again, this isn't a business relationship at this point.
Well, no, it's not technically, but it is an... There is some kind of economic principle to this relationship. There is a give and take.
But what can she take from this relationship?
She could definitely get some control. She can make some requests. She could take him up on the things that he offers her as a kind of, like, you know, well, okay, maybe we haven't gotten quite into that yet. Shouldn't have read ahead. But he's willing to supply her with quite a lot of things that she rejects on principle. And that, I mean, maybe I do agree that she shouldn't be in this relationship, but, like, if she was to be in it, then she would know, like, I should just accept this shit. Like,
well,
you know, if I have to put up with this, I need to be paid my due. But it's just not obvious to her that there is, like, a material and emotional.
Yeah, so you're sort of saying that in lieu of getting any sort of emotional fulfillment, she should just accept material goods?
Sort of. I mean, well, but she should also get some sexual fulfillment, which she does. There is that. You must admit there is that. So...
Yes, but...
I just think that this comes from somebody who just doesn't understand the premise right away. Like, it's not necessarily a bad relationship. Like, yes, I think Christian's a bad person. I think Anastasia's a dumb person. But I don't think that this sort of relationship that I'm being shown here is necessarily a bad thing.
Well,
I don't know if you guys agree with me. I would actually be curious to know what Cherrydoom thinks about it.
Well, I don't think, like, like, in an arrangement where it is set, like, the boundaries are set for, like, dominant submissive, that's one thing. But this is Christian, like, this is his lifestyle in a very different sort of way. Like...
Yeah, okay. I was speaking more to the arrangement rather than to the what happened in this chapter, so...
Yeah, I'm talking about, like, the core of his being is basically to own.
Okay, I'll give you that, because I don't want to talk about it for longer. So, I think that was a really good segue, actually, to the safe word section... I know I just said all those, like, questionable things about my ethics about sexual relationships, but this was my safe word. Quote, I frown. Christian, smitten with me? Hardly. He's just looking for a new toy, a convenient new toy that he can bed and do unspeakable things to. My heart tightens painfully. This is the reality. This might be funny to some of you listeners. Maybe if you want to, like, laugh at my pain, I don't know why you'd want to do that. But, like, this really hurt me because, like, I kind of feel like I've been in that situation, first of all. But second of all, you know, like, earlier I was talking so much about the situational rant that the sex... There was that element of, like, wanting to get away from it on Anastasia's sort of perspective. Like, she was kind of like, oh, how do I get out of here? What is this guy doing here? They sort of have, like, a fake little, like, consent thing at the beginning where she's like, I regret the Heathman right now and bone him. But, like, really that doesn't... That's not enough for me. Like, there needed to be more consent. There needed to be more communication. But he really does just come in and kind of, like, treat her like a toy, which, ugh, it sat with me very, very badly, like, on a personal level. I don't understand how the author can continue to write this book under the pretense that this is, like, a consensual and great relationship. It's not. It's horrible. Not all of it. She obviously seems to enjoy it in parts, but... Something about it, like, I could not read the sex scene more than, like, twice, like, without help. I usually just pick, you know, safe words that are kind of, like, funny or, you know, I don't feel very passionate about them, but I really did feel bad about this one.
I think that the lack of consent is something that's a problem, yeah, but it also happens all the time.
Yeah, I agree.
That's part of why it's so disturbing. She's sort of trying to normalize it.
But the thing is that it is kind of normal. I mean, I know there's so much, like, pushing for, you know, explicit consent now, which is good, but I mean, I feel like it just doesn't happen, like, that the way that people say that it should, or...
Yeah, maybe not, but, and I don't know if you're saying that, like, kind of, people don't really do that, and yet they still, you know, survive and everything, and that's true, but, you know, there's sort of some sections in there where she's, like, kind of trying to escape, to me, it seems like, and I think that's what makes me so uncomfortable, like, the fact that...
Yeah, that's why it's so distressing, it's so realistic, the fact that it is a, well, I mean,
of.
Like, the fact that it is a thing that happens... that's...
I mean, I can understand, like, the sort of the feeling of, like, I'm not sure I want to do this, but I should.
I do think that there is, like, a middle feeling where you're like, ugh, but you're like, oh, yeah. I better keep trying for the other person.
That's
like,
me all
I mean,
time,
I can... I can speak from experience here. I had kind of a bad, I don't think it was like terrible, but recently had a little situation where like I wasn't sure if I should say no, and I didn't really have like the guts at that point to do it, and like I kind of had to rely on my partner to just notice that like I wasn't really ready to do anything,
yeah.
Whatever it was. So like knowing that you can be in that situation, and if your partner is not understanding and they can just like bulldoze right over that, like there's something that's very scary about that for me. So I guess, yeah, it is a pretty personal reading. I know maybe not everybody would get that, but I definitely
I feel
did.
Like, it's again sort of straddling that, you know, this is a consensual, proper BDSM relationship with, you know, dubious consent fantasies. And, you know, I don't know
if it's really presented as that, though.
I mean, it's just that problem that I've been having with this book of... This is a consensual relationship, but it's not really. He's... Okay, my biggest issue, I totally forgot until just now, was that she says no in this email. It was a joke, but she still said no. So he comes over to fuck her, to basically coerce her.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was really disturbing. I thought that he just kind of went there and like, oh, went with the moment. But when you put it that way, and I don't really know if you can not have that reading afterwards, then yes, it is really bad.
That's, like, how I read it. Like, I didn't read it as him being there just like, oh, I'm gonna talk to you. He goes there, like, explicitly to fuck her into compliance.
Yeah.
Oh, that is crazy. I didn't really pick up on that. Okay, now I'm really now I'm even more upset than I already was. That's horrible. Okay, alright, let's move on. What's your safe word, Cherrydoom?
I don't know why I glance up. Maybe I catch a slight movement from the corner of my eye. I don't know. But when I do, he's standing in the doorway of my bedroom watching me intently. I was, like, literally startled reading this. I was like, whoa! Holy
shit!
I
was too! That is such a scary moment. Like, wait! Like, he's there!
It's a very visceral sort of thing. Home invaders and...
It is.
Things out of the corner of your eye.
Yeah. And then, you know, it's basically the beginning of this whole weird sex thing. They add that one part where she lunges at him first.
But she does it as, like, a weird preventative measure, and then he takes control. Like,
not preventative, I would say...
Oh, preemptive, I'm sorry.
Preemptive to what? I don't know.
She knows that he's gonna do some stuff, so she's like, alright, let me try to get some kind of or upper hand
then,
here.
Like, immediately, I feel like she added that in, that part where she lunges first, just to make it slightly less,
It does feel hasty, like writing hasty type
thing.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I'm not cool with this.
I don't like this sex scene at all. I don't like it.
Yeah, I mean, I can't reiterate enough. Like, I literally feel upset. Like, I don't feel good. Like, it makes me upset.
This chapter is sort of like the culmination of all the problems that have been arising throughout the whole book. I have a bunch of stuff. I won't talk about all of it. Let's see. There's the trauma thing again that Anna brings up.
Oh yeah, I really hated this. Yeah, read it out.
Why is he like this? Where she's considering like why he's interested in BDSM, like why he wants to do all the things laid out in the contract or you know, that stuff. There's also this weird implication that like because of her situation, that the way that all of the submissives of Christian, which may be true, we don't know, have been like drawn in the way that she has. There's no way to know this for sure, at least at this point in the book. And then like all the doms are like damaged or something, or anybody interested in being a dominant is damaged or traumatized in some way, which is a thing we've talked about at length.
I reject that out of hand, of course. And I think, yes, we all think that's silly because it is.
But it's worth reiterating. Yeah, we've already talked about Christian a lot, so I won't go over this too much. He is totally taking advantage of her. This is a thing that I hadn't really said yet. He's totally abusing the fact that like Anna just finds him attractive and is like can't resist him to do basically whatever he wants with her. And even though there's a mutual attraction, like he obviously finds something magnetic about her, she isn't taking advantage of that. Every time that something like that is triggered, it's unintentional on her part, whereas every time he does something, it's almost certainly intentional. And he is like using that to get what he wants, and that's exactly what he does in this chapter. Like he shows up, like we just said, basically to have sex with Anna to make her change her mind because he thought that she was serious about saying no, and that was his strategy. His strategy was to go like, huh, well, I'll show you through sexual prowess.
I mean,
My one devil's advocate to that would be, like, it's sort of like a plot point for him to come back and see, be like, see how good we are together, baby! But it's still not okay.
I mean, that's still a problematic trope.
You put it perfectly.
I think we had maybe touched on this a couple times, but I hadn't really thought about it until this chapter because of how explicit it was with her, like, not having any real control, which is sort of supposed to be the point. But the stereotype is really being played into here, where of, like, the man taking control of, like, the sexual situation in a very... I don't even mean, like, the dominant submissive thing. I mean, like, when Anna, like, has an orgasm, she just totally loses control of herself. Christian, on the other hand, is portrayed as being, like, totally, fully, like, tantrically in control of his sexual prowess at all times.
Is he? Yeah, I think comparatively, but I think it might be a question of perspective as well. First-person perspective.
I mean, Anna herself describes herself as, like, losing control. It's part of, like, an old myth about women and sexuality.
Wow. I mean, because for everybody, I don't think it is gender-based.
No, what I'm saying is that, like, the stereotype is that, like, women who are, like, having sexual feelings or lust or anything are out of control. They're hysterical. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, Anna's not in control of her faculties. She's not
making
rational
decisions.
Sorry, I have
to devil's advocate you here and say, aren't you reading into it a little too much?
Well, I think I'm doing a very, like, superficial reading.
Oh, okay.
I think
opposite.
Yeah, I think, like, these are just all surface things. Like, these are all surface problems that are common to romance literature and some...
But I was saying more that the mere presence of it does not imply that that is the rule. Or maybe it does. I don't know. That's always the
problem.
Well,
I think it's playing into that norm, like, that idea.
Sure, okay. I accept.
Do you want to talk about the jealousy stuff?
Sure.
Like, I totally understand Anna's extreme jealousy, but I think it is, again, playing into the stereotype I was just talking about, because she's basically all emotions.
Sure.
And, like, she's not thinking or anything. She's just reacting or, like, emoting it towards everything that's going on in her life right now. And she's, like, extremely jealous and possessive. Yeah, like, they don't really have a relationship yet. I just feel like she's being aggressively territorial for no reason.
However, I do think that she has a reason to be jealous. And I would also like to point out to you that Christian is jealous as well of Jose and of others.
Mm-hmm.
Any other man that comes in, he's jealous. The reason why jealousy arises in any relationship at all is because of some sort of insecurity, either insecurity on the part of the person, insecurity as the relationship goes, like you're not convinced that the other person can control themselves, or maybe you've been burned in the past. Obviously, that's not the case with Anastasia, but I believe that because the bond with Christian is not one that is a traditional one, she doesn't really know where she stands with him, even in spite of this contract. I think that is why people get jealous, and I think that's why she's jealous. I also think that it comes out of her being very self-conscious of her own appearance. Like, whenever a blonde person comes in the fucking room, she gets crazy. So it's insecurity of herself and insecurity of the bond with Christian. So that, I just wanted to address that. That's what I think.
I mean, I totally agree with you. Like, that's pretty much, like, what I think about jealousy. It stems from insecurity. My problem is just how jealous she is. Like,
I do agree that's a bit overblown.
Like, it's just being melodramatic. And it's like a erotic romance novel, so, I mean, it's par for the course. Again, this is a book that's, like, sort of lauded for its progressiveness in certain realms. And that's really the reason I take issue with it. She does have reason to be jealous. It's sort of a natural reaction, and it often does stem from insecurity, almost entirely from insecurity. And you're right, she doesn't know where she stands. Like, that's the main reason she'd be so feeling so insecure about it. But again, I just feel it's, like, the extreme depths of her jealousy that is... I take issue with.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So it would be the spoiler dungeon, but do we even have any questions? Do you guys have any questions?
I do not. No.
That's okay. I mean, like, you don't have to always want to know what happens. Sometimes it's good for there to be a beautiful mystery.
I'm trying to think of what we were talking about that you were hinting about that happens in the next chapter, but.
Right. Okay. So your question, which I'm going to ask for you, is it was whether me and Chad were arguing or disagreeing about what's going to happen next chapter in terms of
Tristan's emotionality, like his his like display of relationship thingy.
Oh, right. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I believe it doesn't happen in the next chapter, but I believe it definitely happens in some chapter. He says he's willing to do that relationship part, but he's not ever done it before, so it's going to be weird. We can try it, he says. I can't find the part where it happens, but it happens sometime between now and chapter 17.
Well, now we don't need to read the rest of the book.
Hooray!
Hooray!
We're almost halfway through, you guys.
we should say bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Laters,
baby.